Welcome, gamers, to this week's episode of Last Call Gaming. We're on episode number 73. My name is Craig Prowse, and joining me is the almost-to-be birthday boy, Randy Montemayor.
Oh, my God, you remember.
What are you now, 24?
Jesus.
You wish, right?
Yeah.
On a good day. Any big plans? I know you have a good, nice birthday dinner.
I'll make sure I wash my hands vigorously, and that's probably about it.
That's it? Sit at home, play games, cry yourself to sleep?
Turn the page and wash my hands. I'll be turning pages and washing hands.
So, guys, leave it in the comments. Happy birthday to our very own Manager Mott.
Thank you.
So, guys, as always, let's do the plugs first, guys. If you want to check us out on any of the social medias, you can follow us on Facebook. You can follow us on Instagram at Last Call Productions. You can follow us on Twitter at Last Call PRODZ. We generally like to drop some other news stories during the week. We do our reviews on video games on there. So if you guys want to follow us on that, please do. And also, if you're looking for the audio only version of the podcast, you can check that out at iTunes, Spotify, and Castbox. And if you guys are looking for any type of merchandise, the link is in the description for the links to TeePublic. You can buy some cool gear and check us out there because the shirts are styling.
We need to come up with a cool design and just, like, rip off whatever, like, this Final Fantasy VII picture, but just put Last Call Gaming down.
Yeah, we're good at, like, graphic arts. I'd love to do that. Speaking of, Andrew got me this for Christmas. This is my new Final Fantasy VII sweater. Show him what I got. Yeah, put it right next to your backpack.
Oh, I got this nice booklet that I actually love reading these crazy records.
Tell them what the booklet is.
It's the Guinness World Record Gamers Edition for 2020. And I actually really like those Guinness ones for the gaming anyways. I don't really care about world records.
Yeah, it's video games only because that's all we really care about.
Yeah, because all that stuff in there I actually think is really fucking interesting.
Yeah, so I can't wait to see which one you try to beat.
I like to go through and I'll sometimes like circle it or whatever. my favorite stuff. A Sharpie that bleeds four pages deep.
Oh, I like that. So, as always, we also like to drink beers around here. And this one was submitted by Dave Worthington.
For the second time.
Which is the Big Blue Van. And yeah, when I was looking at it, I'm like, I think we just recently did a Big Blue Van. But
it's been a while.
He recommended it, so we did it. This one sits at 5.4 and it's brewed by the College Street Brew House, and if I'm not mistaken from last time, it is from, yeah, Lake Havasu. So, you didn't like it then? Do you like it now? I put them on as ice as I could.
Yeah. I don't know if maybe last time we drank them, it's because they were warm or something like that. I don't know.
Or got warmer, because, yeah, now we got koozies on a couple to keep them cold, but
it does taste a lot better. Actually, when I went and had a drink last night with that dude from work, that's actually what he got was Big Blue Van. Nice. And yeah, he's like, oh, you like that beer? I'm like, nah, it sucks.
So a lot of people just either love it or, like, you really dislike it. To me, it just tastes like a blueberry soda. Like, you know, no harm, no foul.
I didn't have any blueberry.
Did you have any blueberry? Maybe we have fucking go. So, pause, grab a drink along with us, and feel free to, as always, to leave a recommendation for next week's video. So, let's dive into what we're getting into today. And, unfortunately, it's not the best of news. CD Projekt Red has been running into issues prior to the launch of the game and now post-launch. And we've kind of looked at it and broke it down into three main things. One is the obvious, the bugs and glitches that it's having along with the stability issues. Two is now the credibility and standing with the fans that it's facing after this whole kind of dilemma. And three is the financial standings and obligations that it's having due to the refunds and the shareholders meetings. And I want to start with the bugs and stability. So to put it into a little bit of context, when people were looking at this game and judging the footage, all of what they saw was based on a high-end PC.
So you mean those reviews that were given at nines?
All the reviews that everyone was saying this game looks great, looks fantastic, was running on the best running version of the game. So, you know, the public, when they look at things like this or watch reviewers discuss it, on paper, the game looks great. But one of the big red flags that was shown was that big outlets like IGN and things like that, they were not given codes to early review the game like how everything else does. And this was kind of to cover the fact that they did not want people to see the poor performances that it was running on the base Xbox One and the PS4. So
I think it's bad when poor performance is an understatement.
Yeah, it's almost disgusting because one of the big things is that this game on the high end should be running at 60 frames per second. But basically speaking, it should be running at 30 FPS, no issues. What it's happening is that the base Xbox One and PS4 are struggling to get over 15. And there's a new patch that just dropped. It was the 1.04 that helps the PS4 kind of run at around 20 FPS, but the bugs are making this game completely unplayable. And after the video footage that Andrew and I watched, it's bad. And crashing is a huge deal. So let me read one quote that IGN actually reviewed it as for the base. And it says, Cyberpunk 2077 on a base PS4 or Xbox One fails to hit even the lowest bar of technical quality one should expect, even when playing on lower-end hardware. It performs so poorly that it makes combat, driving, and what is otherwise a mastercraft of storytelling legitimately difficult to look at. They ranked it a 4. Andrew, I mean, we just watched the video of it. We've been fortunately enough been able to play it on Series X, so we haven't been running into that. But after watching that, I mean, how did it even get this far? These bugs are, like, inexcusable.
It's bad. The game is unplayable. It is absolutely unplayable. Like, that is not an understatement. That's not over-exaggerating. Like, I showed him how bad it was because he had seen a clip earlier. He's like, well, I don't think it's as bad as what they're saying. I'm like, no, here, check this out.
Yeah, what's that? So we're like,
even trying to shoot somebody, it's like all over the place, getting stuck. It's freezing constantly. You have to wait for everything to load in, even to talk to somebody, just to do anything. It's really, really bad. And I definitely think this is a game that should have just cut it. They should have put it out only on like PlayStation 5, Series X, and I somehow taken the financial loss that I think would have, in my mind now, been less than what it recouped for selling it on past consoles. But damn.
Yeah, it's bad. Because here's the other thing, and I like that you kind of brought that up, is that even if you're playing on the Series X or the PS5, you're playing the last gen build of the game. It's just being up-resed and what is it? Dynamic scaling.
Yeah.
That it's running. So our version looks good, but this is still the last gen game. It's not natively playing on the next gen. The native versions of the game don't come out till next year. So the game design specifically for the Series X and the PS5 aren't going to be out till next year. So that's even more confusing that the version we're playing is still the base model version of the game. And I just do not get how that passed. So with that being said, let's move into now, where do they stand? Where's the credibility with the fans? What kind of issues have they had since they launched this game that is very, very unplayable? So they went into, it's been apology after apology with CD Projekt Red. And we've been seeing this as far back as March when the game should have came out all the way till, you know, the final 20-day push in December.
I want to know what it looked like before it was delayed.
Oh, yeah, damn. Because, I mean, I don't know how this thing got as far as it did. So the latest apology, and there's another big yellow, you know, excuse of what they did. But the main thing that I pulled away from it was they quote and say, we would like to start by apologizing to you for not showing Cyberpunk 2077 on base last-gen consoles before it premiered and in consequence not allowing you to make a more informed decision. We should have paid more attention to making it play better on the PlayStation 4 and Xbox One. And this is where a lot of people are going, you know, this is bullshit. This game was starting in development and it was all on all of our minds 7 to 8 years ago. And this is before next gen was even announced. So if the game you were making is on Xbox One and PS4 base, then what do you mean you weren't paying, I wish we would have paid more attention to it. What were you doing for the last 6-7 years?
I don't know how, I don't know the behinds of like how the studio runs that in their mind that they thought next gen was more precedent, unless it's just, hey, this is easier, let's start with this. Because realistically, let's say you are building a game, you want to aim for the bigger market, and the bigger market was not next gen. The bigger market would have been base Xbox Ones, PS4s.
The millions and everyone's home
already. Yeah, the Pros and the Xs and the Series Ss. Something like that would have been your biggest market share to try to get. And that's the version that runs the shittiest. Not to mention, I don't know for the level that it's at. One, they should have delayed last-gen port. I don't know what they should have done. Besides canceled altogether, like you said. But the fact that you have Gears of War, which I thought looked really good. That's a good-looking game. Or, yeah, The Last of Us 2. Those both worked perfectly fine on last-gen consoles, and those are both games that kind of push graphics kind of, you know, more and further that I don't even know how base stuff on this game, even with all the like shaders and the settings and all the stuff you can try to do to make it like as minimal as possible to where things aren't going. You can't even like fucking walk outside in this game, which when you're walking out in the like desert and stuff like that, I don't think it looks any better than like a Fallout or something like that, because it's just desert and tumbleweeds and bushes and stuff like that. The fact that this game can't even do something base that a game from like two generations ago does fine is ridiculous.
Yeah, because the comment just does not make sense. Oh, I'm sorry we didn't pay enough attention. Because it is bullshit that they it was smoke and mirrors. They faked it with showing the best version. Because the PC, if you're playing on the PC right now, people are saying it's the game of the year. Like, the game, there's game of the year material in this. But for the mass audience, you know, the people that weren't fortunate enough to get next-gen games that are still on their Xbox Ones and PS4, you know, not including the One X or the PS4 Pro, some people still have this. The game is bad, and they're trying to say, oh, sorry, we didn't mean to. And it's just like, it's a slap in the face to the consumer. But you gotta, this is where I kind of draw a split, I guess, in shades of gray. There's a difference between what the development was trying to do, right? The guys that kept pushing it back, saying, we need more time, versus, you know, the higher end tax, you know, the brass tacks that are saying we need to make our money back. And it's extremely unfortunate. And the only thing I kept looking at is when this game was launched, like talked about it like 73s ago or something. It reminds me of like the John Romero when he's like, Daikatana is going to make you its bitch. And then Cyberpunk did a thing. And now kind of similarly is they were like Cyberpunk, you know, and then it would come to release date. It's like when it's ready. So they kind of put on this big showcase being like, if this game takes us 7 years, it's going to take 7 years because what we're going to deliver is going to be the best. And now we're here, and it's arguably the worst thing we've seen in a decade.
On base consoles, again, I had to go and like look up footage because I don't have any problems on... I've had like weird small issues on my playing on the Series X, but it's no more than what you would find in like a normal Bethesda game. Like someone's smoking and they're done, and the cigarette's like still floating, or... I was talking to like this robot AI and like just his eyes hadn't loaded in and it took a while before they popped in. Then I almost thought it was, okay, this maybe isn't the real AI that I'm talking to and that's why his eyes are black to make a difference for whatever. But either way, I haven't had any like major, nothing like any of that. Yeah. I was like, oh, well, I feel like maybe it's kind of overblown and I don't see what the big fuss is about. I had to go and find videos about it.
Yeah. I've had issues because no one's saying that the game wasn't going to have bugs. I mean, a game this big and this anticipated, especially the guys that are coming off of The Witcher. If anyone remembers, Witcher 2 and 3, they launched buggy, right? They were almost unplayable. You know, give them time, they patch it and everything works. But Cyberpunk, you know, in a world where we're doing patch culture, I don't know how it ever got this far.
That's the definition of patch culture.
This game looks like it needs another year. And I just don't know if, you know, the higher-ups were ready to afford that. So... we want to move into now the financial aspect of this. Yeah. Do you have anything else you want to add on their credibility and the lies to the people?
They should change their like logo to the guy from Popeye. It's like, we'll give you a broken game or pay us today and we'll give you a fully working game on Tuesday. Yeah. That Tuesday fucking never comes.
Oh, if anyone can draw out there, because we can't, I'd love to see something like that because I haven't seen a meme like that at all. So the next thing they went into was their refunds that they were talking about. You know, they were saying, if this game, you know, if it was unsatisfactory to you, then we're going to issue refunds. And CD Projekt Red kind of blanketed it saying, you know,
go get your refunds today.
Ask your refunds from PlayStation, ask them from Microsoft, and, you know, it'll be taken care of, which really was untrue because, you know, Sony and Microsoft have their own guidelines of what can be, you know, legally contracting to what can be refunded. And a company saying, oh, they'll do it for you. It's like, that's not how it works. So that kind of backfired in their face. And then it went to going, okay, well, if you guys are having issues, email us and, you know, we'll help you out from there. And it's kind of been redirected to being just, you know, kind of help cues and being like,
wait until later.
And now it's being pushed back as far as saying, you know, you have till the end of 2020 to get a response. And Sony's kind of looking at it going, hey, this isn't our fault. Because there are two big patches coming, one in January, one in February, that's supposed to be fixing, I think it said 90% of the issues that everyone's seeing. So at this point, they're saying, hey, sit on it and wait.
Play
and
it later.
Eventually, yeah, give it, you know, 60 days and you'll have it. And, you know, what can you do?
Now, even actually GameStop had a memo that leaked out that said if anyone comes in, Of course, you cannot refund an open game as per their policy, which is fine and dandy and right. everything
CD
like
Project
that.
CD Projekt can't override that.
Yeah, but instead of maybe CD Projekt Red eating that cost or something like that, which they eat it another way, but GameStop literally has a memo. It's like, don't refund the people. You can't do anything about it. Send them to this email, and it's pretty much their help queue for... hey, sit on it. Wait, and we'll get to it when we get to it, guys.
Yeah, so I don't know what they're going to do with that because it's just... Because there's articles still popping up. I was just looking them up in the last 2 hours that are just like, this is still a debacle. And even bigger outlets, when they were trying to test the theory of getting refunds, it seems that if you were on... If you had the Microsoft Xbox versions, they're more willing to help you and refund
you. I've heard that you've had better luck on that.
But Sony is like, this is not our fucking problem.
Yeah.
This is theirs, and this does not fit our guidelines. So... It's unfortunate that so many people had to deal with this because I know the majority of people are still playing on some of the older base consoles, you know, waiting for their version to jump to the next gen. But the big headline that a lot of people are kind of showing off is that because of this, that CD Projekt Red has taken over $1 billion hit. And that's in terms of their stock share. Their stock share dropped over 30%. So... And the reason why it's kind of gaining this traction is that it did it in less than 10 days, right? From the financial call they had, I think on the 8th or something like that, till today being December 17th, they've lost a shitload. So Bloomberg went on to say this. The technical glitches plaguing CD Projekt's Cyberpunk 2077 game have cut more than $1 billion off the wealth of the company's founders. Perhaps most seriously, the quality first image of the studio has been shaken and may not be easy to win back. CD Projekt shares plunged by a third over the past 6 days as a number of bugs plaguing the highly anticipated futuristic game prompted an apology from the firm and an offer for refunds of gamers on previous generation consoles. Short sellers have also started targeting the stock, with short interest up from less than 1% of free float in September to 8.3% on Monday, according to market data. Now, it sounds a little more intimidating than it is, and to not to dive into like stocks and monies and stuff like that. Yeah, they took a big hit, but when you have a bad product, that tends to happen, especially with shareholders. When you look at what they actually lost, their market cap is only around, like, I think it's like 8.5 or something like that. So they lost about $2.5 billion, which is a lot. You know, we're still talking billions. But when you look at companies that are like Activision, Blizzard, and EA, those companies sit around $68 billion and $41 billion. So if you were to see a 33% drop in a company like Blizzard,
right,
that when it's tens of billions, then it's devastating. So... I think people are blowing this a tad out of proportion with, you know, they lost over $1 billion. To them, it was percentage that I think is definitely recoupable. But again, Andrew, we got to talk. Did they lose all their clout and merit with fans? I mean, I'm curious of, can anybody, you know, really trust them again on their next game? Or would pre-orders ever be a thing with them again?
I think everyone's going to talk shit and say, like, oh, no, fuck them. Like, I'm not going to pre-order. But as soon as they were to drop the name The Witcher 4, it's not going to matter.
Right? So,
and especially, I mean, how many people didn't get burned? I didn't get burned. You didn't get burned.
I'm having a blast. Me, yeah. And Andrew, we are just showing off my character to Andrew. I'm having a blast. But again, we're on the Series X, so I'm noticing minimal things. So I don't know how many bridges it actually burned.
Yeah, so, I mean, that's the thing. And again, dropping a name like The Witcher 4, it's the same thing like with Bethesda and everything else. Like, Fallout 76 was a shit show, and that game's hot trash. But as soon as they announce the next Skyrim or something else like that, it's all is forgotten. You know, this next game, this next big thing that's the hugest thing ever is here, and we're going to be all about it. Or what's that other game?
No Man's Sky?
No, not No Man's Sky. The other... Not Elder Scrolls, the other Starfield? One that they're doing, Starfield. As soon as that thing comes along, everyone's going to forget about Fallout 76. It's not going to matter.
Yeah, because I was thinking, even on like No Man's Sky, launched badly, badly. They just won an award the other day for best continuing game. So it's one thing to hype about the news. This game, should it ever have been launched? No. But I think the general consensus is give it February. No one's gonna, this will be swept under the rug. I don't think a lot of people are gonna keep talking about it. It's big news now because it was the most anticipated game of the year. I would even say over, you know, Assassin's Creed Valhalla.
Right, for sure.
But come February, come March, when it's patched and everyone's playing it, I don't think it's gonna be as big as an issue as most people are making it right now. And I think that the 2.5, I think that stock's gonna go back up.
I hope this game just stands to prove like a lesson. So someone like Microsoft or something like that, where they tried to I mean, Halo didn't look anywhere near as bad as what any of this did or anything.
They were
like,
let's pump the brakes.
Yeah, but I mean, if it's just not working or even still, like, just cut it. Just cut the last consoles and just move forward. Give people a reason to jump to that next gen. And I understand why people aren't about that life right now because there's a console shortage. But as far as I know, Halo's not supposed to come out till at least summer or end of next year. November and hopefully 15th
or something like that?
Yeah, hopefully you've got a better supply of stuff then. So, you know, at least have something to show for it.
Yeah, and it's interesting. I like that you brought that up too because Cyberpunk didn't want to obviously lose the sales. And I get the whole concept of let's not leave a generation behind. But this is the red flare, the signal that says, like, Halo Infinite is still saying that they're going to do last gen. Cut the fucking cord. And maybe that's why they pushed it back a year. I think because if Cyberpunk had another year, we wouldn't be talking about this.
As far as I know, I think Resident Evil 8 is an only next gen game.
Yeah, Cyberpunk should have been, they should have, if they would have saw that it was that bad, they should have cut it and said, let's move it to next gen. And I think anybody that's teetering on making a game that's split between the generations or covering all, you know, what, 7 platforms at this point should just be, let's start moving into the next gen because let's not ever do that again because we all just saw what happened.
If I'm not mistaken, I think Mortal Kombat X actually did that. I want to say that they put out the game and it came to next gen only first and then they canceled the 360 and the PS3 ports because they just realized we're not going to get it to work. It's not going to be good. It's too much whatever. We're sorry. And it is what it is.
Even that that Pokemon clone, I think it's called Temtem. We were looking at it a while ago. Oh, they were supposed to, it's an MMO that they were supposed to be on last gen, this gen, Switch and all that. They cut the cord. They were like, we use the term cut the cord because it's a phrase, but they cut off last gen. They're saying, no, we're just going to do PS5, Xbox, but you know, the Switch kind of falls in that weird gap. And we're just doing that. And I'm like, I think a lot of people are seeing what's going on and like, hey, you know what? Sorry if you don't have one, but eventually everyone will. And let's make the best version and not deal with scaled down versions and worry about native versions of them later. And I think that's, as of right now, the smart move.
It beats the alternative.
It beats the alternative. So anything else you want to add on that? I know it's a lot of things to kind of throw at people, but I felt like those three things were kind of the biggest deal that's going on.
Nah, it's a lot to digest. And I mean, either way, I'm having a blast playing
for a game we really like. I'm enjoying every second. Can't wait till Andrew leaves so I can keep playing it.
Yeah, right? That's the first thing I'm going to do when I get home is keep playing, so.
So, guys, let us know in the comments what you think. If you've been playing CD Projekt Red's game, Cyberpunk 2077, if you've been having issues, I don't really know too many people, at least in our circle of friends, that still have base models. So I haven't talked to anybody that's really had that issue outside of just watching YouTube videos and things like that. Most people I know are up to the 1X and the 1S.
Yeah, if you're somebody who got this game on a base console and you're having to hit it, please let us know in the comments. I would love to hear about it.
Yeah, I would like to know that too. So that is our first topic. Andrew, what's our next story?
So on another cyber-related disaster is that a while ago, Capcom actually got hacked by a group of hackers, and they didn't give in to their demands, unfortunately. And so they leaked all of Capcom's plans pretty much up until 2024. So all the new Resident Evils, Monster Hunters, pretty much the next Street Fighter, everything. But what just came out recently, at the start of this week actually, is that there's a playable developer's version of Resident Evil 8. That you can play front to back. It's pretty much a skeleton of the game that hits all the story points. So all the spoilers are out there. So the intro, what the characters are, the ending, there's screenshots, there's all kinds of different things on there. So pretty much a playable version front to back is out there right now. So if you're not into spoilers or anything like that, be careful. I actually caved in and looked because I'm really interested in this new one. I have no fucking clue where this series is going, and it's one of my favorite series of all time, if not my favorite series of all time. So either way, I just thought that sucks for them. More so, now there's no big surprise either, too. So not only is your game, like, this game's technically ruined because a lot of the story and stuff's out there, but hey, when we announce that next cool game that's going to be a surprise, whatever, no, it's not a surprise. I read about it a year ago.
Yeah, It's extremely unfortunate. Andrew's busting my balls over here because this was a story he wanted to tackle a couple weeks ago. But at that point, it was just, you know, a company gets hacked. And in my mind, I'm like, Nintendo's been through it. Sony's been through it. You know, but this is just the developer. Like, how big can it actually be? And yeah, they got bombed on. I don't know who Capcom pissed the fuck off. Ransomware is attacking these guys, and I don't want to say dismantling them, but not only did they reveal everything from 2024, but you know, they also took over 350,000 pieces of personal information from the company, names, addresses, top of, yeah, cell phones. And now the biggest game, you know, arguably, if you know, if you think Resident Evil is still their top dog, you know, a game that they're looking forward to after especially 2 did great, 3 did very well. Everyone really likes 7, Biohazard. You know, 8's their next thing. And if you're going to pull all the punches out of it, then, you know, it's almost like kind of when The Last of Us Part 2 got taken apart. You know, 6 months before, but that was 6 months
because before, it leaked, yeah.
Because it leaked, you know, when you take all the gas out of something, you know, that's actually on a pretty good roll, that's a bummer. And I don't know what Capcom, you know, what can you do? Because it is a skeleton kind of version of the game. Maybe things change, maybe they don't. Maybe that lineup kind of changes. But when you've dismantled someone's, you know, next 5-year plan, you can't really, you know, you can't call it audible and be like, oh, well, let's switch this up or do this. It's like, what can you really do? And I really don't know.
Yeah, so I mean, that kind of, I mean, more than the game leaking, I think that is the biggest kind of bummer for them. And I mean, you can find the list on there unless you like don't want to be hyped. Is, I mean, I'm excited for the stuff to come, but yeah, I mean, they have really, outside of, you know, the people who really don't kind of watch that stuff, they have no like big hype moment, because now everything, it's okay. We already knew. I know. We know that one was coming. Oh, cool trailer, but we already knew.
Yeah, no eyes on their events, you know, nothing like that.
Yeah, because I think there's even, like, another game in there, too, that's been, like, a long-dormant franchise, and it says, like, remake, which is super exciting, but, again, now when they show out the trailer, I'm like, oh, damn, that's really cool. That's exciting, but I already knew it was coming.
What I'm curious is how are they able to get so much? I mean, if there's
I have no clue.
Cyber hackers doing this to things like Capcom, you know, one of the biggest names in the industry, what are they bypassing? A and B, why aren't they doing, you know, why isn't any other big developer publisher being hit by this? You know, why isn't something like EA or Activision doing that? So it's got to be, I feel like, something that Capcom did or didn't do. And I don't know, maybe their cyber defenses weren't up to snuff compared to anything else. Because you can't just, I mean, that's so odd to pull out that much info and then to have a full game. Like, I do not get it.
Yeah, that's actually the craziest thing, too. So yeah. All the other hacks is like, personal information and stuff like that, that's obviously worse than a list, but I've never seen another company that's like, okay, well, cool. Hey, we have your next 5 years details. We're just going to post it online. Like, here's everything that you were ever going to try to hide and create that hype moment. Here's your game plan for the future.
Yeah, that's a bummer, because it's very sad right now, because, you know, a lot of companies are not doing so well. Capcom's not doing well on this end. CD Projekt Red's not doing good on their end. Square Enix, which arguably could have had their best year ever with Final Fantasy VII, took it on the, you know, hit on the mouth with that $600 million bomb with Marvel Avengers. So I don't know, man, these guys need to start figuring this out and quickly, because we don't like talking about bad news, and unfortunately that's what the two big things are this week. So
I will give you a spoiler on the leaked list, and I'll give you a second to go away now, and that is that Resident Evil Outbreak was listed on that list. And some people said it's a misprint, it could be something else, but either way, my dream is alive, and I'm really hoping.
You know, for only being 4 or 5 years, there was quite a bit of games.
There was a lot of shit on there.
I was like,
yeah,
you guys are, that's like, what, 2-3 a year? Almost 1 a quarter, it would look like, that they were going to be dropping games. So that slate is now ruined in terms of delivery power, but for the fan that likes to peek behind the curtain, a lot of solid titles. So anything else you want to add on that?
No.
So I want to move into a little ripping it up, 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 up. And I will start, because I think you always start. The Nintendo Indie World that launched on 12/15/20, so just 2 days ago, launched. And if you guys are Switch owners, which I am, you are. I am a Switch owner. There's a lot of good stuff. And as well as they're doing with you know, porting over big AAA titles, everyone wants to see like The Witcher 3 on it. I think Nintendo's bread and butter is capturing those old, you know, kind of independent style platforming games. So if you watch this, there's probably about 15 titles or so on there. It's 17 minutes or something like that. And it's got a lot of good stuff, but two that caught my eye was the Tunchi game. I think it was out of Peru, hand-drawn. It was like the four characters. Kind of reminded me of like how the new Streets of Rage is updated. Right. Side-scroller, beat-em-up. But the one that really caught my eye was Cyber Shadow. This game looks like it's definitely, you know, it's 8-bit cool. For sure. Solid music. It looks just like it when it came out on Nintendo. It looks great. So check, and I'm sure the trailer's playing right now. So it looks awesome. And that game actually comes out January 26th, 2021 action platformer game. I'm definitely going to be picking that up.
Yeah, I watched it too. I besides that game, the other cool one that I actually like, Super Meat Boy and Super Meat Boy 2 Forever. Super Meat Boy Forever 2 is actually coming out on the 23rd. So they had some more gameplay of that, and that looked good. I actually found kind of though that besides those two games, the more interesting stuff was the stuff they're like, oh, well, we'll have more to announce in the future when they did the montage at the end, like the trash,
yeah, a lot of
like the trash island fucking game where they're like fighting the alligators and stuff or whatever. All that stuff I thought looked far more interesting than what they showed off on this one.
Yeah, a lot a lot of stuff that they were showing on the end was kind of 2021 stuff. So, you know, the next Indie World they do in January or two or whatever, they'll probably showcase that more.
Yeah, so either way, I mean, I like what they're doing with those, you know, little shows and stuff. It's not too long, and I felt like this one, again, this one would maybe be the weaker one out of all the ones we've seen recently, but...
Yeah, good stuff. Check it out. I do want to add, though, on that Meat Boy, is this... I don't know how often Nintendo does this. It's a timed exclusive.
Oh, yeah.
So, you know, I mean, obviously, the Nintendo games are exclusive to the console, per se, but when does Nintendo get a game exclusive? I think it's a year before anything else. So they got Super Meat Boy Forever as a timed exclusive on Nintendo. This just shows that Xbox and PlayStation can do their shit with next gen. Nintendo's still rolling strong.
Yeah.
So super like that. What was your riff or rip up?
So my riff, speaking of Capcom, is actually about the Monster Hunter movie that just premiered. And actually, everyone's hating it. It's getting really bad reviews. I haven't seen it, so again, it's all personal opinion. The only reason I want to bring it up is just because, again, I hope that it seems like it's the case because he already ruined Resident Evil with his wife as well, Wes Anderson and fucking Mila Jovovich. But they just go on to do it again to where it's just, fuck the story, fuck whatever the heart of the movie is. It's just me, my wife, and we're fucking trucking along, and that's why you're here for whatever. So either way, it just sucks, especially coming off of Detective Pikachu and Sonic and stuff like that, to think, okay, cool, now we're finally getting a step in the right direction for how movies are supposed to be for video games, just to fucking dive right back down.
Yeah, bummer. What did they actually give it? Wasn't it like a three or something like that? Yeah. And I'm sure we're going to watch it. I like a lot of bad video game movies, so I think we'll probably like it, but...
It says it in the review that it is not a case of it's so bad that it's good. And I was like, oh, well, that sucks, because like Mortal Kombat 2 is so bad that I can watch it because it's still kind of good to me. But again, we're still hoping for more, because this is in the wake of the upcoming... They just announced Mortal Kombat's release date for next year, and also Resident Evil's being rebooted. And I follow a couple of the people that are on, have like set photos and stuff like that on Instagram, and actually it looks like they're going pretty faithful to the series. They have like the RPD, the mansion, and their outfits, the way everything's done.
You can't be mad
so
at that.
I'm really hopeful for that stuff, that it does not end up like this, because it's stuff like that that makes video games not be taken seriously when you just put out dog shit like
that. Yeah, it's weird, because a lot of dog shit video game movies are just from a product of their time. I mean, you can say that, like, Assassin's Creed was, you know, was bad because they didn't follow it, but like Monster Hunter looked good on paper. I liked the trailer. I thought it was gonna be good, but I guess we'll be the judges if it deserved that 3. I got a feeling it's gonna stack right up in that 6 era for me.
I don't know about that, because I'd give like a 6 or 7. Realistically, if I'm being objective, a 6 or 7 to Doom starring The Rock. But that movie for me on a personal level is like a 10.
Dude, solid 11 for me.
I fucking love that movie.
So Andrew, riffs are done. Let's move into, what are you playing?
I am actually playing Cyberpunk 2077 on a working console version.
Oh!
And Call of Duty also, which Season 1 just dropped. So they have now mashed it with Cold War.
We just bought Cold War and Phoenix.
Immortals, so Phoenix Rising. So, I'll definitely be checking out Cold War now, even though I haven't been crazy about it. I only bought it because I play a ton of Warzone. Because
we want to play the campaign.
So, those are the only two things I'm playing right now. I'm actually really loving Cyberpunk. I really enjoy the story. I think Keanu Reeves' character is sick. The spoiler alert, he's in there a lot more than what I thought he was.
Yes.
I thought he was just going to be some, like, fucking side character. Maybe you do a couple missions for him or something like that, and then you're done with him. He's very prevalent in that game, and he's one of my favorite parts of that game when he shows up. He's badass.
I don't want to say steals the show, because without...
He definitely does when you first meet him.
Because when you watch the trailer, you're assuming it's your character doing all those things. He's right there with you. He's just as much a co-star in this game as the main character V is. And I as well have played Cyberpunk, beat it. I'm loving
the campaign.
Wait, what else do you beat in the game?
I don't know, all the side stuff.
Oh boy, okay, I beat the campaign, and I gotta say, wait to play it. If you do not have a next gen console or even the higher last gens, wait to play it, because the game is extremely fun. A little short on my end, but there's a lot to do. So if you guys are looking to play Cyberpunk, wait if you can, or if you have a next gen, play it. I've done all the endings so far. There's five, I think, total. Four or five endings. All extremely different. All extremely fun. I wish there was more to the main story, because I think you can cap this game around 18 to 20. And a lot of the stuff it wants you to do is like level 33. So it's just, at that point, you're just doing more side quests and clearing up the map, which is a lot of fun.
Sounds right for me, because I got a bunch of other shit to play. But also, I remember going through The Witcher 3, and I was like, man, this game's a fucking slog right now.
Slogger nogger. So after Cyberpunk's done, because I got a few achievements I want to clean up, I'm diving back into Monster Sanctuary, which is on the Game Pass right now. Other than that...
You're not going to 100% Haven?
Haven sucks! Other than that, next episode, I'll probably say more of what I'm playing. As of right now, I want to finish that and do that. So... that is the end of that. Andrew, let's move into video game questions of the week. And we just have one for today. Ooh, the show is already running a tad long. So this comes from Sheila T, and she says, so since you boys are big gamers, here's a question. If video games didn't exist anymore, what would take its place, or what would you be doing instead? Hashtag last call gaming. Think outside the box, bro. You're back in your MMA career?
Yeah. No, actually, before I played video games a lot, but not as much as I do now. I was actually super into skateboarding. That's where you could always fucking find me from, like, dusk till dawn. Even when it's dark, I would go find a random place here in town that actually had, like, a light and, like, a good surface. And I used to skate constantly all the time. So I feel like I would probably do that a lot more, because I do have a skateboard now, and I kind of go every now and then, not as much as I would like to, but...
the indoor hobby?
I think that would be I think, nah.
More comic book collecting, maybe?
I don't think that would replace, like, an active thing. Like, what am I going to sit there and, like...
turn the page and wash my hands.
Yeah.
Wash your hands. I like the question, because I would feel... because I've been wanting to get the video game podcast going. I would think maybe if we weren't mainly talking about video games, maybe we'd be doing a movie podcast or something like that, or maybe TV show reveal. So maybe something like that. But... a personal hobby, I would say, would probably be reading more books. Like, I am falling behind. Me and Gino bought... it's over there. But Gino's standing on them. There's a book series. So three books. Gino already cruised through them. I'm still halfway through number two.
You can read?
I didn't know you could read. I read at a ninth grade level, sir. And I'm a big fan of books. Maybe I'd be reading more books. Maybe playing a little more Dungeons and Dragons. There's a game. We record on Thursdays. There's a game down at the Wasteland that is always on Thursdays. And, like, I can never go to it, because I'm always like... and they're just one-off. So, like, you don't have to dive into, like, you know, a 10-year adventure. They're just quick little sessions. And I can never get to them because video game takes precedence in my life. So, I guess those would be the hobbies. Feel free to leave yours. And, again, anyone watching this, guys, if you make it this far, please leave your comments down below, because I love hearing what other people have to do. So, that is the end of that. That is the end of that. Now, guys... as you know, we have a contest going on. If you want to see what it's about, how you win it, then check it out right now. Welcome, guys, to the official Last Call Gaming 3-pack giveaway. This is going to be the contest where we give the winner a choice of their games on the Xbox One, the new Series X and S, the PS4, the PS5, or the Switch. So if you win this contest, you can mix and match it between any of those systems. Now, as of right now, any and all countries are available for this contest. So regardless of where you live, we will find a way to either get the games to you, whether you want them physically or digitally. Now, the contest is running, it already has started, and it started on November 26th. It's gonna run all the way to January 7th, 2021, and the winner will be announced on January 8th. Now, episode-wise, watch our Last Call Gaming episodes. It started on episode 70, and it's going to run all the way to episode 75. And the winner will be announced on episode 76. So that will be early in January 2021. Once the winner is announced, guys, we will give you all the way till the end of January to pick out which three games you want, what systems you want to want, and how you would like to play them. Again, whether that be physically or digitally. So guys, best of luck to you. Make sure you check out all the episodes. Make sure you guys enter, because the comment that you need to enter is Last Call Gaming. Make sure you put that in all the episodes from 70 to 75. That is going to be how we pick the winners.
All right, guys, that is how you enter the contest. That is how you win the contest. So make sure you guys enter. Make sure you tell your friends about it. But that brings us to the end of this delightful show. Not a fan of Mongo, are we?
Not the Corona ones, now.
You are going to learn to love them. So, Andrew, we discussed a lot, talked a lot, covered a lot. Anything else you want to say to the kids?
Yeah, Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas, guys. Be safe. That is next week. We do have our show coming out. That we're not going to skip that at all. And then we also make sure you guys stay tuned. Our top five video games of 2020 will be coming before the year is up. So I cannot wait to do that, because I'm really curious what your list is going to be. I think I've got mine pretty well together, but I do want to play Phoenix Immortals before I solidify it.
I'll probably do mine after Cyberpunk. So I feel like Cyberpunk would be on it, but again, I really have to go back on my list.
Cyberpunk is fantastic, and again, check it out.
Immortals might beat out Haven for you.
Well, what'd you say? Beat out Haven? Fuck Haven! It's not getting there, bro. I swear to God, if it's on your list,
I'm gonna put it as number one.
We're gonna have some seer ish. Alrighty, guys, so that is the end of episode 73. Make sure you guys check us out on all the medias again, as always. But until next time, Andrew, that is Major Montemayor. I am Craig Perales. Cheers.
Only if it's Die Hard, it'd be the first time I've seen it this year.
No, Die Hard's not my staple for Christmas movies. I'm a big Polar Express guy.
I hate the Polar Express. It is not a good movie.
I like it. Obviously, Christmas Story. I don't know if you're a fan.
No. I can watch it, but I don't think it's as good as people make it out to be.
Oh, no, it's the best.
I think it's like
another... It's the best genre piece.
I think it's like a Breakfast Club for me. Like, I think it sucks, but
it is. You never seen Breakfast Club?
I've seen Breakfast Club a million times. It really sucks.
Why would you watch it a million times if it sucks?
To give it a chance, I guess.
A million chances?
Yeah. Well, that's like shit. You're a kid at your grandma's and you're just too lazy to get up and change the channel.
So what do you watch for Christmas?
Sometimes The Nightmare Before Christmas.
Yeah, I watch that.
I watch Die Hard.
You just said you've never seen it.
I haven't seen it this year.
Oh. I thought you said you've never seen it in general.
No, usually I watch like Die Hard once. But I usually always watch The Grinch, though.
Well, we already watched Home Alone. I usually like watching that during Christmas.
I'll watch Home Alone 1 and 2. But I always watch The Grinch.
What? Oh, you know what?
Jim Carrey's The Grinch, the good one.
Fuck that movie. Did you ever watch...
That movie's a Christmas staple.
Did you ever watch Rise of the Guardians?
No, I haven't seen it.
I remember only seeing it once. I remember really liking it. I would like to watch that.
I try to watch it, but I don't have a reliable way as much to watch it anymore. But I like to watch Charlie Brown's Christmas.
I'd watch that.
Because I love his pathetic tree.
Did you watch Klaus at all? Or Klaus, whatever they're calling it? Uh-oh, let's mute that.
Are you talking about the one with the demon who, like, stuffs people into their fucking sack and shit?
No, it's an animated movie. It's J.K. Simmons is Santa Claus voicing him.
No.
And Jason Schwartzman is he's like a mailman that gets sent to the North Pole because he embarrassed his dad or something, so he has to work his way back up, and it's these two feuding families.
I usually watch
it's like a different origin story on like a real Santa Claus.
No, I've never seen it.
That's pretty good.
Oh, I was thinking of Krampus.
Fuck that.
I always watch I like Christmas with the Cranks with Tim Allen.
I watch Christmas with the Cranks.
And Christina fucking loves
the Santa Claus. And I always do my Love Actually, so there's my dedicated Christmas movie.
Christina loves the Santa Claus.
I could really watch some Harry Potter's Sorcerer's Stone.
I don't care for Harry Potter up until the Goblet of Fire.
Goblet of Fire is the best.
But I don't care for the Santa Claus too much, but she loves it. So I'll watch the Santa Claus.
But that's the Tim Allen one you're talking about?
Yeah, the other. What's that's the other Tim Allen one.
What's the
Christmas of the
Pigs? No, no, no. That Kurt Russell one.
Where he's Santa Claus?
Yeah.
I haven't seen that.
The Christmas Chronicles or something. Part 2 just came out.
Didn't that come out like last year?
Or 2 years ago, because now number 2 just came out. I don't know if it's a movie or a show.
How often do you watch I'll Be Home for Christmas with
JTT? I love me. So I want to watch Jingle All the Way.
Oh, I love Jingle All the Way.
I'd like to watch that. Let's make that.
He's got two.
He's got two. Dude, Arnold Schwarzenegger is the best. It's turbo time.
I love that that's what everyone was comparing the PS5 and Xbox shortage to. They're like, I haven't seen a shortage this bad since, and then it had fucking, like, Jingle All the Way.